Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Well, thank you for joining us here at the Council for a conversation with Pervez Musharraf. This is billed as a conversation rather than as a speech followed by questions and answers. So I've been given the marching orders from the CFR to do my best imitation of John Stewart. And that was fine with General Musharraf, who has made several appearances on The Daily Show, which I recommend you see. The ground rules, I understand, for this morning are it's on the record, and we have a number of folks from the press in and among us. I would ask you two things. First of all, please turn off your cell phones or put them on vibrate. And secondly, when you ask or comment something with General Musharraf, please, first of all, identify yourself by name and, if you would, your institution, and also try and speak as clearly as you can since this is being broadcast also to our Washington office. And sometimes it's difficult for listeners there to follow the question. So I was supposed to be John Stewart for about 20 minutes.
Very good.
And, engage the general in a conversation, and then we'll turn it to a broader give and take. And I think the first question might be, how are you planning to re-enter Pakistani politics, particularly if, as Prime Minister Gilani joked in September, the person greeting you at the airport might be the former Justice Minister, Iftikhar Chowdhury?
Well, I'm going to enter through the democratic political process, in that I've created a party of my own, the All Pakistan Muslim League, and I'm going to fight the next election. Now, easier said than done. I agree with this statement, but I don't think that is the factual position. I don't think it's going to happen like that. The cases against me have no legs to stand, absolutely, and that is very sure. There is only one case at this moment, and that is also politicized. So we'll fight the cases in the courts, and I don't think it's going to be as a doomsday scenario as being painted, that Iftikhar Chowdhury will be waiting for me at the airport. Nothing
well,
of that sort
well, that's
will
good.
Happen.
That's good. Who do you see as your political allies?
I believe in breaking the political status quo, and I have defined it as the parties who have been tested and tried three times over and failed Pakistan. We have to find another political alternative. So all others can be my allies.
Would you have some kind of an alliance with, probably not Nawaz Sharif, but and probably not President Zardari either? Who do you see as a constituency for your return to politics?
Well, Nawaz Sharif has been tested and tried three times over. His party is running Punjab, the biggest province of Pakistan, and running it to the ground, in fact. So therefore, he's the one against whom I have said we have to break the political status quo. Other than him, certainly, and then he's got nothing other in his agenda than to speak against me. So possibly I don't see a change of heart in the near future at all. So it's parties other than these, as I said, who've been tested and tried, and there are a number of them with whom one can get into an alliance. But first of all, at this moment, I'm trying to organize and structure my own party in Pakistan, take it down to the grassroots level. We already have opened, we have committees, organizing committees in every province of Pakistan. And then we have gone down to 82 of the 124 districts of Pakistan. Now I've told them to go down to the Tehsil, which is a sub-district, and even to the Union Council, there are about 6,500. So we are doing that. I'm organizing and structuring the party right down to the grassroots level, because this is a new party of 1 year old.
Well, in addition to party structure, What organizing principles for the future of Pakistan does this party stand for, and that you presumably would run on?
Yes, the first thing, I know that more than 60% of people of Pakistan do not vote. Who are these 60%? I have analyzed, and these 60% are generally the educated class, women, youth, and minorities. Now, I personally feel if we have to create a new political alternative and create a new political culture, change the political culture, this 60% have to be encouraged to come out and vote. And I think they are prepared to do that because of the terrible condition that Pakistan finds itself in and the dismay and the total demoralization of the public. People are prepared to rise, especially the youth and the educated class. So I'm hoping a lot on this, this change. And because of this trouble of Pakistan, I think people will vote for a change.
How much is economics going to factor?
It is one of the main factors. Normally, if you ask a man in the street, the man in the street is only bothered about his own feeding his children, feeding himself. Cheap food available, inflation under control, poverty being reduced, job creation, employment generation. This is what they are looking for. And also now, energy. There is no electricity in Pakistan, unfortunately. Electricity is there. The generation capacity is about 18,500 megawatts, that I know. But presently, the government is generating only 10,000 megawatts because they are not being able to pay the bills. And therefore, the power producer is not paying to the oil and gas producer. So there is an energy crisis. And people are literally out on the streets, in the streets. So it is poverty alleviation, job creation, energy, inflation control. These are the issues that are bothering the common man.
If you were to re-enter electoral politics in Pakistan and succeed in forging a coalition of some type, what would be the effect on civil-military relations?
Should improve, certainly, because I personally feel one of the problems of Pakistan at this moment is that the pillars of state, first of all, are not are at confrontation with each other, the legislative, the judicial, and the executive. And then the organs of state do not have a commonality of thought and action at this moment. All organs of state, instruments of state. So therefore, I think the requirement is to have unity of thought and action, first of all, between the all pillars of state and all organs of the state that administer Pakistan. So I personally think I can have a positive impact on that because I am from the military and now I am trying to contest against people on their ground, and that is the political field.
What grades would you assign to General Ashfaq Kayani in his dealings with the civilian government in Pakistan? I mean, as you know, you promoted him through the ranks. You appointed him the 10th Corps commander. You assigned him to the ISI during his tour there. How well do you think he has managed civil-military relations in Pakistan? Before we turn, of course, to the foreign policy.
I don't have a direct first-hand information on this. So I would prefer reserving my comments on it. The problem that the army chief always has, is that whenever Pakistan is being misgoverned, people run to the army, unfortunately. The army chief, I would say, not to the army, but the army chief. So therefore, there is tremendous load and pressure on him being developed by the people of Pakistan from all walks of life to save Pakistan, to do something. That becomes the problem with the army chief. So I presume he's handling it as best as he can.
What grades would you assign for his handling of the relationship with the United States?
Well, the taste of the pudding is in its eating. I think it is the United States-Pakistan relations are at their lowest ebb. Therefore, whoever is involved is failing.
How much lower do you think it can go?
How much lower can it go? I think there's hardly any space left.
It's only up from here, huh? What do you see as a way out of this? Do you see, if there is one, do you see U.S. and Pakistani interest as so fundamentally divergent at this point that things will remain as abrasive as they are? Or do you see a way out of this?
No, not at all. I think this is one perception that I would like to certainly in this August gathering rectify. The overall direction, the overall strategy of Pakistan and United States against terrorism and extremism, against Al-Qaeda and Taliban, is certainly the same. The issue is in the modalities, the handling, the dispositions of each against, in tactical matters. There may be differences there, but that must not cloud. And that is the problem, actually, that we start thinking that at the strategic level, as a policy, Pakistan has changed its policy. How can Pakistan change its policy when they have suffered 35,000 dead civilians, about more than 3,000 soldiers being killed, and about over 300 intelligence ISI operatives attacked and killed? The officers being killed, generals killed, and their children killed. Now, who's doing this? Certainly the same enemy. So therefore, I think the problem is we need to understand the strategic level and the tactical level. Let the tactical level not cloud our commonality of interest. That is what I think. There are differences, unfortunately, which have occurred because of, I personally feel, because of lack of communication. I don't think such differences were there in my time. Why? Because when I look back, because I had a certain relationship with President Bush and General Colin Powell also. We could pick up the phone. We could speak to each other, which we used to do very frequently. And that was the issue. There's a misunderstanding. We clarify it on telephone. In fact, Colin Powell and myself, we always had a term now, general to a general. We are speaking general to a general. And we used to clarify. Now, I wonder whether that communication is there. And in this communication, we must be very, very frank in talking to each other. Very straight, very frank. The two issues, if I'm allowed to give a little longer answer to this, the two issues which bedevil on the Pakistan side, which need to be clarified by Pakistan, is how is that Osama bin Laden was in Abbottabad? Is this complicity or negligence? I know it is negligence. I'm sure. I don't know, but I'm sure. Now, Pakistan has to prove that it is negligence and not complicity. A very difficult task, I do understand. The other is Siraj Haqqani. Why is Pakistan not acting against Siraj Haqqani? This is the other issue. Which Pakistan, onus of proving this to Pakistan or convincing United States, there is no ill intention at the policy level, has to be done by Pakistan. But on the United States side, may I suggest, if United States is leaving in 2014, what kind of Afghanistan are you leaving? Is it that there will be an instability in Afghanistan? Are you going to surely leave a stable Afghanistan or there will be instability? And if there is instability, I personally feel Afghanistan will go back to 1989 when United States left after Soviet defeat and each ethnic group, about 10 groups were fighting among themselves and total anarchy in Afghanistan, or 1996 when Taliban were on the northern side and Northern Alliance on the other side, Uzbek, Tajik, Hazaras. Now, which of these two conditions will prevail in Afghanistan? Or is it going to be a stable Afghanistan? I would like to discuss with the United States if I was the leader. And I would like to have some assurances from the United States because it is the security of Pakistan involved. And Pakistan is the direct effectee of all this. And secondly, may I also add that India, now India-Afghan relations are bothering Pakistan. I personally feel India is trying to create an anti-Pakistan Afghanistan. And I have tremendous intelligence from my own time to prove this. I know it. So therefore, if this is happening in our backyard, if somebody is stabbing us in the back, then, well, we have to make some arrangements.
Well, General Musharraf, could I ask you one question on that, one further question on that, before we turn to a broader discussion of this? And that is that, as you know, there are two narratives about Pakistan's strategy towards Afghanistan that you can hear in Islamabad and, in fact, are discussed in the press and the media. And the first narrative is that, similar to what you just said, the first narrative is that Pakistan's interests in Afghanistan are essentially aligned with those of the U.S., that Pakistan would prefer a stable Afghanistan in which the Taliban, maybe the Quetta Shura Taliban, plays a minority but not a dominating role, and that Afghanistan is sufficiently stable that the Pakistani government can then focus on its real existential threat, which is the domestic terrorist groups who have waged a campaign of terror against the Pakistan state. That's one narrative. But the other narrative is quite opposite. The other narrative says that the Americans are gone after 2014, that the primary strategic objective for Pakistan is to keep Indian influence at a minimum or zero, if possible, and that therefore groups like the Haqqani Network are essentially a hedge, a card to be played so that Pakistan can ensure itself enough control in Afghanistan once the Americans and their allies are gone. Which of those two narratives do you think best reflects the views of the Pakistani government and the military in particular?
Both the narratives have some commonality as far as Pakistan is concerned. Pakistan is interested in the fallout, is interested to safeguard itself from the fallout of what happened in Afghanistan. Now I would like to ask you a question. Why does India want influence in Afghanistan? Do they want to stretch out to the Central Asian republics? Is this some action against China? I mean, what is their requirement? To all this audience, I would like to ask. The requirement is to trouble Pakistan. Because all the intelligence people, their diplomats, Afghan diplomats, intelligence people, security people, army, they go to India for training. I have been bending backwards to tell Afghanistan and President Karzai, send them to Pakistan. All our training institutions open, free of cost. Not one has come, even to date. What is the issue? What is the issue? Nobody is trying to understand Pakistan's point of view. The issue is an anti-Pakistan Afghanistan, and this is nothing new. This has historically been the case. Right since the time of our independence, Afghanistan has been in the eastern camp under the influence of Soviet Union and India. RAW of India, KGB of Soviet Union have always been in league with CARD of Afghanistan, the intelligence agencies, and always troubling Pakistan. Now, who do they use? We must historically know. It is the minority Tajiks, especially Panjshiris. Now, even today, Panjshiris are being assisted by Russia and India. Hazaras are being assisted by Iran. Where does Pakistan go in this whole situation? Why doesn't anyone understand what should we do about such things? If India is trying to influence there, using a minority which is anti-Pakistan, how does Pakistan fend for itself? We would like to, if United States is my ally and I am in the lead role, I would like to request this ally of mine, please help me out. Please understand my situation. So this is the issue. So therefore, it's not a case of Pakistan doesn't want. Pakistan wants a stable Afghanistan, certainly. A stable Afghanistan which does not affect Pakistan. There are 4 million refugees who came into Pakistan. 2 or 2.5 million are still there. They don't go back. More than the population of many countries of Europe. Now, these are our problems. We get affected. So therefore, I think one must understand Pakistan's situation. We want a stable Afghanistan, and we don't want any outside interference. We don't want to interfere in Afghanistan. There is a lot of misperception being created all over the world that Pakistan wants a totally dominated Afghanistan from its side. Never, it has never been historically, and now also it is not going to be.
Well, with that as an opening, and I have to ask one more question then before we open it. What do you see as the prospects for a negotiated political settlement in Afghanistan? And what role do you believe Pakistan would be willing to play, both in helping those negotiations take place and also in helping to see that the terms are honored?
Yeah. We had a great opportunity between 2002 and 2004 when the military, U.S. military, won a victory against the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. They ran into the mountains and cities of Pakistan. There was a void in Afghanistan. The Taliban structure entirely was dismantled. Now, this military victory should have been converted into a political victory. And political victory meaning a balanced, ethnically balanced, proportionally represented government in Kabul, meaning that the majority Pakhtun, which is 50%, being in the dominant position in Kabul. It was doable if we had weaned away for Pakhtuns from the Taliban at that time when there was a political void. Unfortunately, we did not grasp this situation which presented itself for 2 years because Taliban resurgence started in 2004, early 2004. And we kept governing Afghanistan with Panjshiri minority, which is 8% of Afghanistan. And never has Afghanistan been governed by anyone other than Pakhtuns. So we still carry on doing this. So now we are in a situation, sorry for this background. Now coming to this question, now what can we do? Now we are talking of discussing with Taliban. Whereas at that time, my view was, wean away Pakhtun from Taliban. We are not discussing with Taliban. We need to differentiate between Pakhtun and Taliban. Every Pakhtun is not a Taliban. All Taliban may be Pakhtun. But all Pakhtuns are not Talibans. This argument was never, unfortunately, was not understood. And we carried on this path of governing through Panjshiris. Now we have to have a political settlement. And a political settlement is really a Pakhtun-dominated settlement. We have to include the ethnic majority of 50%. I mean, it's not a small majority. And therefore, we want to talk to Pakhtuns, and we are prepared to talk to Taliban. Now, Taliban is not a monolith. Mullah Omar is a Taliban, Siraj Haqqani is a Taliban, Gulbuddin Hikmatyar is a Taliban, TTP of Pakistan is a Taliban, TNSM of Pakistan is a Taliban. So who are we discussing with? I don't know. Which Taliban? So we need to identify, is there a group of Taliban or Pakhtuns who are for peace, who are against war? And then discuss with them and maybe include them in government. Can Pakistan help? Certainly Pakistan can help. Because Pakistan has been involved in Afghanistan since 1979 when we were with you fighting the Soviets. And these Mujahideen, the Al-Qaeda, are the Mujahideen of 80s. 25,000 of them brought in here by us because we launched a jihad there. So we have been dealing with them, we have been dealing with the Taliban because we encouraged armed Taliban and sent them inside from Pakistan tribal agencies. When I say we, United States and Pakistan. So then United States left, and since 1996, when Taliban came on the scene, Pakistan has been dealing with the Taliban because we were the only ones who recognized them. So we, Pakistan can certainly help. But if President Karzai and Afghanistan find it very suitable to have a strategic agreement with India, well, I don't know then, what do you expect from Pakistan? What should we expect from Pakistan? Where do we stand?
But sounds a lot like narrative number two in that case, if there's no peace agreement. If I could ask, General, this is a good time, I think, to turn to an interactive Q&A with the audience. I believe there are microphones around. And stand up if you can, or wave a hand and repeat your identification and ask a question as clearly as possible for the benefit of our colleagues in Washington. I know this gentleman, Ambassador Speltz.
General, first of all, thank you very much. And speaking from times back, we thank you very much for your support at a critical phase when we went into Afghanistan. With regard to the geopolitical, military, et cetera, I leave that to Jim and other experts in the room, but I'd like to ask you about the most important phase of success in your career there that we worked together on with former Prime Minister Aziz, and that's on the economy. So two questions tied together. If you are going back into office or going back to office, what specifically will you do to turn the economy or try to turn the economy around, which became a beacon to bring foreign direct investment into you? And number two, are you willing to work with former Prime Minister Aziz and or even in switch roles?
Even to switch roles? Switch roles with me? First of all, economy. Yes, indeed, sir. Economy is the backbone of everything. We cannot do anything in Pakistan unless we turn the economy around. There's no doubt in my mind. Now, we have to understand why the economy went down. Immediately after the elections in 2008, February 2008, within 6 months, the dollar, which was maintained at 60 rupees, went up to 87 rupees. Why? Because there was a massive flight of capital, people of Pakistan taking money out. The other issue was FDI being drying up. Therefore, your balance of payment deficit increased. They started taking more loans. And when you take more loans, your debt service liability is increasing. So in effect, the budget deficit kept increasing. And the debt to GDP ratio is getting out of control again. It was 103% initially. We brought it down to 52%, which is better than the benchmark of European Union, which maintains about a 60% debt to GDP ratio. Now, what do we have to do? Balance the budget. And can we balance the budget? Yes, indeed, we can balance the budget. On the fiscal deficit, we initially, our expenditure is on running the government, our defense, and some subsidies to various government corporations. We reduced the subsidies. I froze the defense budget for 3 years and reduced government expenditure. On the other side, we increased the revenue 300% from 308 billion to we crossed 1 trillion. Can we increase from 1 trillion? Yes. We had evolved a strategy in 2007, Shaukat Aziz and myself, to increase the 1 trillion to 4.5 trillion in 5 years. Doable, because people are not paying taxes. We need to increase the base without increasing taxes. It is doable. Even if we double it, even then we'll turn the fiscal deficit. On the balance of payment side, yes, FDI has to be increased, remittances have to be increased, and exports have to be increased. All are doable. And then I think we need to, I reduced the debt service liability by going to the Paris Club, who we owed about $13 billion, rescheduled the entire debts, and saved about $3 billion a year. Maybe we need to look into that again. How do we reduce this overall expenditure of debt service liability? I think it's all doable with understanding, but proper governance. The other issue of Shaukat Aziz, Frankly, I brought him in 1999 from the Citibank when I hadn't even met him. I never met him, but I was told that he may be able to deliver as finance minister. Now, he did deliver on the finance minister as finance minister under me. Now, then he became the prime minister of Pakistan. Now, he entered politics maybe, and in politics, there are a lot of problems in that. So if he wants to get involved now, he has to come into politics. And I wonder whether then you need some courage and guts also to get back into Pakistan now. I don't know. I'll ask him, is he up to that courage and guts? I haven't considered that really.
Well, that's a very interesting answer. There's a gentleman in the back, in the middle, and then KT.
My name is Chandrakant Pancholi from Overseas India Weekly. This Afghanistan, Pakistan, Kashmir, and India. You are blaming India for influence in Afghanistan when India is blaming that Pakistan is sending terrorists there. So what is the solution? And is there a Chinese influence, Chinese military present in Pak-occupied Kashmir?
No, not at all. Your terrorist is somebody else's freedom fighter, by the way, so may I say. So, but however, yes, there are, in 1989, when freedom struggle started in Kashmir, back in 1989, there were dozens of Mujahideen groups which erupted from our society in Pakistan, because there was tremendous public sympathy. All these much maligned names as Lashkar-e-Tayyaba, Hizbul Mujahideen, Jaish Muhammad are all products of the 90s, where people were volunteering to go into Kashmir and fight the Indian Army. This is the reality on ground. And Pakistan, while we were having religious militancy from the West, from Afghanistan, because of what happened between 79-89 against the Soviet Union, and then 89 onwards, it is happening from the West. There is another religious militancy because of what is happening in Kashmir, because there is tremendous public support in Pakistan, that has religious militancy in Pakistan. So we are a victim from the East and the West. The core issue, if I may confine now to India and Pakistan, is Kashmir dispute. We must resolve the Kashmir dispute, which has a United Nations resolution of 1948, unimplemented. So forget that resolution, but at least move forward and let us resolve the Kashmir dispute, so that those who are going there to fight with the Kashmiris, who they call brothers, and they want to go there, help them against the Indian Army. Pakistan is relieved of this religious militancy, and it has tremendous public sympathy. Pakistan government or Pakistan Army doesn't have to do anything about it. People are prepared to go en masse into Kashmir and fight. All that Pakistan can do maybe is to stop them by force. So we have to realize the realities on ground, and this is what needs to be done.
That's a fairly concise statement of the Pakistan government position on Kashmir. KT, she could do a John Stewart imitation. She has her own show on Fox TV.
Hi, I'm KT McFarland from Fox News. Let's go to option two, the second narrative that Dr. Shinn was talking about, where the U.S. and Pakistan don't find a convergence of issues. They don't, and there is no settlement. And the United States pressure, you know, the Afghanistan war is unpopular. We want to leave. Aid to Pakistan in Congress is becoming increasingly unpopular. What if the United States doesn't just leave Afghanistan, but decides we've had it with Pakistan? You've talked about if we leave Afghanistan prematurely, there'll be some kind of civil war, basically, is what you said. What happens if we quit Pakistan? We stop having aid to Pakistan, military or economic assistance. What happens then?
Well, if the United States stops assistance to Pakistan, let me tell you, it is not the assistance to Pakistan. If we are thinking that the military assistance to Pakistan or the economic assistance to Pakistan, is at a level that Pakistan's economy will entirely get crippled is not the case. Please understand, when even in my time, there were a lot of aspersions that we were given $10 billion over 6 years. Actually, that $10 billion, $5 billion out of that $10 billion was captioned reimbursements for services provided. I just don't understand. Everywhere that I went in my time, $10 billion, everyone is talking of $10 billion. $5 billion was our money, reimbursement of service provided. So now leaving $5 billion aside, which was the assistance, over 6 years, half was socioeconomic, half was military. Now if you are talking of military, you divide $2.5 billion by six, $400 million a year. Madam, if we think that Pakistan military is only banking of $400 million from the United States, we are sadly mistaken. That's not the entire money that Pakistan needs. Pakistan needs, military needs much more. And it spends from its own budget, from its own money. So therefore, Pakistan military will carry on doing for Pakistan whatever it is required to do. It will suffer a little, certainly, because that amount may not be coming forthcoming. But then Pakistan has to readjust, maybe find other sources of assistance. But it has to continue, and it will continue. There were sanctions imposed on Pakistan in 1989-1990, the Presley Amendment. In fact, $600 million, which were paid to United States in cash for 40 F-16s, neither were the F-16s given nor the cash returned till they were returned in kind in my time in 2000 and 2001. So did Pakistan crumble? Did the army vanish somewhere? No, it didn't vanish anywhere. We have our own resources. And what United States gives is certainly an assistance. But if we think Pakistan survives only because of U.S. assistance, we are divorced from reality.
Jeff Laurenti, please.
Jim, Jeff Laurenti with the Century Foundation. Mr. President, the Taliban emirate in Afghanistan had been a pretty good deal for Pakistan. That is, it was the only Afghan government that was allied with, even dependent on, Pakistan. And yet even the ISI had difficulties with the religious absolutism of the Taliban regime. What do you think would lead them into any kind of political compromise with the rest of Afghan society in a proposed settlement? Are they still so religiously absolutist that they see nothing but absolute control as the objective? How can Pakistan help bring them along to accept a share of the pie playing by rules? And then forgive this, you know, this segue.
Yeah.
It is. But on your side of the border, do you see their ideological brethren, Pakistani Taliban, the Islamists, as part of your coalition of the anti-PPP, anti-Nawaz Sharif majority?
No. Unfortunately, over these years, the situation has become very, very complicated as far as Taliban are concerned. Now, let's get some basic truths first. Is Pakistan or the majority, vast majority in Pakistan, are they of the same mindset as Taliban? Firstly, is that? No, they are not. Vast majority of Pakistanis do not like Taliban, and since they have been doing these bomb blasts and killing 35,000 civilians, they are disliked, people are worried, what kind of people are they? They slaughter people. They have slaughtered those who voted in Swat after TTP had left and defeated in my time in 2007. And 2007, we held elections, but unfortunately, the elected government allowed them to come back. They slaughtered the pro-government people. So therefore, people are not with them. We recognized them in 1996. Not that we had the same thoughts. In my time, we had recognized the Taliban. It is not that I believed in their obscurantist views of Islam? Not at all. And vast majority of Pakistan are against their obscurantist. They realize that they are obscurantist in views. This is the reality. But however, the complication is that on the Pakistan side now, there are a number of Taliban in the tribal agencies. And then there are, even in the settled district now, in Swat and Malakand, there is a TTP, Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. Now this TTP head is Fazlullah. And there is a TNSM, head being Sufi Muhammad. Now these people have developed a nexus with the Taliban in Afghanistan and the tribal agency Taliban. Now therefore, Siraj Haqqani, I don't know whether he has a nexus with these Taliban. Now where his nexus with these Taliban is concerned, they are certainly troubling Pakistan a hell of a lot. So this TTP is the main culprit in all the suicide bombings. So they have to be dealt with very strongly. But when you come to Siraj Haqqani, I know that he has helped in getting our ambassador is released. It is this group who got one of our ambassadors who was kidnapped, released. There was some issue with the military where he or some group assisted. Now this is intelligence work of what they are doing. That doesn't mean that we are with him or abetting in him going across and attacking United States. It is just a complicated issue which Pakistan and Pakistan's intelligence have to handle, various issues that erupt. So in some cases, Pakistan's interest may be against them. In some cases, Pakistan's interest may be to use them for some positive ways. So this is all a tactical handling of issues that arise in this complicated area of Pakistan and that tribal agency and frontier province, which Pakistan has to handle, which nobody else seems to be understanding. As I said right in the beginning, we must understand that strategically, Pakistan's direction, Pakistan's policy is anti-Taliban, anti-Al-Qaeda, anti-terrorism and extremism. But how they are handling this situation may be irritating to United States in some areas. That needs to be resolved.
Sir, Mr. Siddiqui.
General, thank you for being here. My name is Mustafa Siddiqui with Blackstone. On the U.S. side of narratives, I think an important element of many of the narratives one hears in the U.S. is a doomsday scenario involving Pakistan's nuclear weapons and somehow an element of the religious extremist fringe getting their hands on those nuclear weapons. I was wondering if you might comment on the likelihood of such a scenario and then what would have to happen for such a scenario to arise.
What would happen to, sorry?
The likelihood of such a scenario and then what factors would have to fall into place for such a doomsday scenario to arise?
Right. Now, Pakistan's nuclear capability is its existential compulsion. So let me clarify this first of all. We are nuclear and missile capability is because we suffered from an existential threat. Therefore, we went nuclear. We went nuclear because a nuclear threat developed in our region because of the nuclear explosion in 1974 by India and then again in 1998 by India. So while we followed a strategy of minimum defensive deterrence militarily, converting this strategy into quantifying it into Army, Navy, Air Force in the conventional sense, when India decided to go nuclear and started testing missiles, this strategy of Pakistan of minimum defensive deterrence became untenable in the unconventional field. Therefore, Pakistan decided to be nuclear and have missiles. Now, where are these kept? Are they, the issue is their controls. Are they safe? Yes, sir. I believe they are safe because of the custodial control that we instituted back in 2000, and I did that. I am very proud of the fact that I did that. previously the development and the holding was all by science organizations who did not know much about holding, frankly. So now we created an NCA, National Command Authority. Under it, we created an SPD, Strategic Planning Division, a huge secretariat, and centralized security and finances with this secretariat to control. And we created an Army Strategic Force Command of a core of the Army, about 18,000 strength, having divisions headed by major generals, under them brigades and regiments. So it's a core of the Army. This is the strength which holds assets. So while development is science organizations, holding is the military. It is the military which holds all assets. And may I say, the assets are dispersed and in places which are exceptionally secure. That's what I can certainly vouch for. So anyone who wants to get them will have to fight the army and also get into very, very, very inaccessible places. So this is one. But however, if the whole government in Pakistan goes into religious extremists' hands, religious groups or religious political parties, that is a different issue altogether. Then it is they who govern Pakistan, and all assets of Pakistan are under their control. But having said that, today only about 3% seats in Pakistan's assemblies have been won by religious groups, political parties. So I don't see them winning in the future also. So therefore, I think the nuclear assets of Pakistan are safe with the military, and I think they'll stay that way.
There's a gentleman with a red tie.
Alan Dodd-Frank from the Daily Beast. Given your perspective on Osama bin Laden, what should the United States and Pakistan do about Mullah Omar?
We have a common responsibility for every terrorist, extremist, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, fighting us, fighting you, fighting us. What disturbs anyone in Pakistan is when all blame is always attributed to Pakistan, like dealing with any extremist terrorist who may be going across the borders, is Pakistan must do it. Stopping movement across the border, Pakistan must do it. Why is Pakistan responsible for everything? Why isn't cross-border terrorism or cross-border movement equally the responsibility of the United States and Afghanistan? Let's share 50-50. We are failing. You are also failing because the border is common. I have been saying, let us mine the borders. Let us fence the border. Nobody agreed. So why is it our responsibility only? Now, if Siraj Haqqani keeps going to and fro from across the border in Afghanistan, why isn't his elimination equally the job of United States and Afghanistan? Why, if Mullah Omar comes into Quetta Shura or whatever, why isn't his movement and interception the responsibility of United States also? So cutting the long answer short, the enemy is common. The dealing, let us stop this blame game against each other, because that becomes counterproductive. And Mullah Omar has to be dealt with, whether on Pakistan side or on Afghan side. Responsibility is common.
Is Siraj Haqqani an enemy of Pakistan?
If he is helping TTP, no, because I don't have, frankly, my comments are not based on intelligence now. My views are maybe 3 years old. Beyond 3 years when I left, my views are through whatever sources I read or hear or discuss with somebody or the other. So I cannot claim that my views are something which is extremely authentic through intelligent sources. So let me admit that. Now, if Siraj Haqqani, there are two problems with Siraj Haqqani, certainly. One, if he is in league with TTP and helping TTP, then he is Pakistan's enemy. Because TTP is doing so much damage in Pakistan. Then, if Siraj Haqqani is going across the border and bringing a bad name to Pakistan and creating rift between US and Pakistan, certainly Pakistan must address the issue and satisfy US concerns of this action if he's going across and fighting United States from our territory. So I think that is the situation, and Pakistan, I said it very clearly, the onus of satisfying U.S. concerns on Haqqani group, why we are not acting against him? Is it that we are overstretched? Is it that he's too strong? Or is it that we have a different strategy and different timings? Lies with Pakistan. I do agree.
Yes, sir.
David Lay, AIG. You said much earlier on that obviously the economy is critical to everything. If you came back to power, what would be your strategy towards Balochistan, which is the site of Pakistan's natural gas reserves? As a general, would you be minded to crush the insurgents, or as a civilian politician, would you think of granting Balochistan some measure of autonomy?
First of all, the natural resources of Balochistan, if you spoke about the gas, let me tell you, sir, only now, Sui gas was the main source once upon a time. If you know, sir, Sui gas and Balochistan's gas is only 18% of Pakistan's gas now. Most of the gas is in Sindh and now a field in the frontier province. So let's get our facts straight first. Balochistan's gas is only 18% of Pakistan's gas. It's no more the only producer. Now coming to natural resources, yes indeed, we have a very big natural resource there in the form of copper gold mine at Rikodik. If you are referring to that, yes indeed, this is one of the biggest copper gold mines maybe of the world. We brought in 2006, I brought in Chileans and Canadians to mine them. And they were continuing, and now, but I find some trouble going on now. I think they want to change them for whatever reasons, I don't know. But otherwise, we would have been on the copper gold map of the world in 2011, because the gold content of copper is very high there. And there is coal, there is iron also. But the problem has been that we didn't develop the communication infrastructure there. So therefore, these were inaccessible. So we have to develop roads, we have to develop railways and port, I developed the port, I have developed many roads interconnecting Balochistan with the other provinces and the main. We were in the process of developing railway lines. So all this has to be done. However, when you are talking of now, another sensitive issue of anti-Pakistan elements in Balochistan, no country in the world can allow any anti-state elements existing in the country. If we are talking of leniency against anti-state elements, I am not in agreement with you, sir. And every country of the world has a right to deal with anti-state elements. But if they have some different political ideas within the state, certainly they are acceptable and they are adjustable. Anything is acceptable. So I really do not know what you are referring to. So in Balochistan, there were some elements who were anti-state. But if we know Balochistan ethnically, sir, 50% of Balochistan are Baloch and 50% Pakhtuns. Pakhtuns are absolutely with Pakistan and they are anti-Taliban. They are not Taliban also. The southern part is Makran. Makran coast are different people. So I think we need to understand ethnically and within the Baloch area, the development that happened in my time in 8 years is more than, and I say this with full assurance and guarantee, is more than the development that took place in 50 years of Pakistan. Okay. All the development took place there. Now, in spite of that, there are some elements who tend to be anti-Pakistan, and they are being facilitated and encouraged from across the border. That is what I was talking of, anti-Pakistan, Afghanistan, sir.
Well, General Musharraf, we have, there's an iron rule here that we have to end it at 9 o'clock. In fact, I was getting the hook sign from our masters over here. Would you have any final message, either for this group or, for that matter, for the U.S. government, in the wake of the big strategy meeting in Islamabad the week before last?
I think the message ought to be that this these relations between Pakistan and the United States are definitely must improve. Now, there is a responsibility of Pakistan and a responsibility of the United States. I have identified the two, the areas. And I think this a statement of Pakistan needs to do enough, is not doing enough and needs to do more, I think is irritating every man in the street now. We have suffered 35,000 dead. We have suffered 3,000 army people dead, ISI people dead. So one of the remarks which aptly justifies what I am saying, recently when Secretary Hillary Clinton was there, one of the ladies asked her a very interesting, made a statement. She said, "You are like a mother-in-law who has never been satisfied, who never gets satisfied. All the time you are asking us to do more. We are doing so much. We're bending backward, but we still have to do more." So I think we need to understand this mother-in-law attitude is not very helpful to Pakistan-U.S. relations.
On that point, thank you.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.